Gentleman yields back the Mr. Chabot.
Thank you. Director Ray, since you last testified before this committee, our country has faced increased threats, be it malware and ransomware to our computer networks, gang members crossing our southern border and committing horrific crimes here within the United States, groups like Antifa attempting to burn down federal courthouses, the January 6th attack, as we've mentioned, on the Capitol, and the surge of illicit drugs killing so many Americans. We are facing multiple national security threats, all of which need the full attention of agencies like the one that you oversee, the FBI. I'll first ask you about cyber attacks. Ransomware terrorists have brazenly disrupted the operations of countless hospitals, schools, city governments, emergency services, even our congressional offices, and an untold number of businesses because they typically pay the ransom quietly. Last fall, cyber criminals were able to compromise patient records and personal information from a hospital in a senior living community in my district. And more recently, high-profile ransomware attacks on Colonial Pipeline and JBS, a meat processing company, caused major disruptions to our oil and food supply. I've seen it estimated that there's a victim of a ransomware attack every 11 seconds, that they're already costing us $20 billion a year, and that you've compared the challenge, as Mr. Cohen mentioned, to the September 11th, 2001 attack on our nation. Mr. Director, the Biden administration, basically, I mentioned the attack on the Colonial Pipeline, basically gave a wink and a nod to paying off the thugs. And I know some of that money was gotten back, but don't we need to clarify the policy relative to paying off criminals? Aren't we just inviting more attacks when you pay off these thugs?
Well, Congressman, I appreciate the question, and I share your concern about and that's partly why I've made some of the comments that I've made publicly about the effect of ransomware and the threat that it poses and the challenge and what it requires from all of us to deal with it. It is our policy, it is our guidance from the FBI that companies should not pay the ransom for a number of reasons. One, the one that you mentioned, which is that it encourages more of this kind of activity. But then there's second, some more practical issues, which sometimes the encryption or the locking up of the system that the actors engage in may not be undone. You could pay the ransom and not get your system back, and that's not unknown to happen. But the third and the most important thing is whether the company pays or not, what we really need is to make sure that the companies or other organizations who are victimized reach out and coordinate with the FBI and with our partners as quickly and promptly as possible. And it's when they do that enables us to take all sorts of creative action that we can't always do, but that certain cases we can, and speed matters, which is why, for example, in the Colonial instance, we were able to essentially seize and confiscate the clear majority of the ransom that was extracted. In other cases, again, not common, but it does happen, we're able to actually get the encryption keys and unlock the system even without the company paying the ransom. And so the whole bunch of things we can do to prevent this activity from occurring if, whether they pay the ransom or not, they communicate and coordinate and work closely with law enforcement right out of the gate. That's, I think, is the most important part.
Thank you, Mr. Director. I got two more questions. I only have time for one. The Centers for Disease Control announced that there's been an increase in overdose deaths. The prevalence of fentanyl is the main thing. Comes from China, comes across our southern border. Myself, I and Bob Latta have introduced legislation relative to fentanyl analogs, which are very similar, can be changed. They get around the law with that. But my question to you is relative to fentanyl and the analogs as well. The chaos at our southern border, doesn't this play right into the drug cartels, are the current policies down there on the southern border, isn't more of that drug coming in and killing far too many Americans? Don't we really need to control that southern border?
Well, I absolutely agree that the security situation at the southwest border is of great concern, both from a perspective of drug trafficking, human trafficking, violence on both sides of the border, corruption, et cetera. And certainly we are trying to do our part to contribute to that because, as you mentioned, the scourge of opioids, opioid abuse, fentanyl in particular, is something that is sweeping the country, and I know that in your home state that's a particularly significant concern. We from our end are trying to attack the problem through a variety of means. We're going after not just the professionals, the prescribers from that end of it. We're going after the dark web where it's trafficked there. We're going after the gangs that distribute it here locally. We're going after the source through our transnational organized crime efforts. So there's a whole bunch of things that we're doing with our partners, but make no mistake, this goes beyond, way beyond law enforcement into other agencies and frankly, the community as well.
Gentlemen, his time is expired.